From where did you all hear, or you all didn't hear anything what I said, Mihika?
Ma'am, we didn't hear.
Okay, sorry. So I just said that we started last time from Praxis and we went through all this. This is what we went through, first year, second year. We went through the videos, third year, how the organization happens. We did this and we ended here. Ragini, this is the place we ended last time. From where we are taking off now, as that is understanding Praxis, the neuroscience behind the whole perspective of Praxis. And that's where I want to bring you all to the videos, which are very interesting, which have been shared by Ragini. Thanks to her. Can you all see the video?
Yes,
Ragini, you want to say something about this video?
Yeah, so I she's my cousin's daughter. I just shared this video because I felt that, you know, we need to understand at what age the Praxis starts, actually, since ma'am had already covered the development of it, how the finger movements start, how the movement actually, body position, body scheme, the child started understanding by themselves at what particular age, and how it develops slowly. So this girl, you know, she's exploring the environment, she's exploring things, she's exploring her own body parts as well. And this is what is missing in our kids. This is, I just felt. So when we have the first session, the observation sessions, we need to really see the whether the child is using his body and the environment optimally or not.
So I would like to add here, there are two ways in which the child processes information. And there are again two very interesting papers which I have read yesterday night on this. One is a child learns by imitation. So that is that. These are the basis of your SIPET test. Though I had put those slides, but then I said, let's see. I have those slides, and if it is necessary, we will talk about it after Ragini's SIPET tests. So one is definitely by if I say something. Okay, lift your right hand up, put your left hand on your right ear. So if I say this, that is following a voluntary command. That is one way of learning. Second way of learning is exploring. See, that's what she is doing exactly, by self-exploration. And the third way is by gesturing and imitation. So there are various ways in which Praxis is imbibed in the human system as a child, and the child finds most of these ways very naturally simple when the neural systems are, and also the other systems are in place. Remind me later. Okay, so now going to understanding Praxis, we start from here. So development, as she said, of self concept and body schema starts from infancy and goes up to 2 years. That's exactly what was seen in the videos which we saw in the last talk and even now. And it's very important to look as therapists, if you see kids who are performing their normal activities, just see we as therapists are very adept at looking at what is atypical. But unless we understand what is typical, you as a therapist will not be able to define what is atypical. So look at typical, understand typical. If you want to become a good pediatric therapist, please understand what is typical and learn to look and study the normal development, not from the textbooks, not from your any notes. Look at the babies. What are they doing? What are they using? Simple things. Start making notes. Okay, she's using a self-initiated behavior. She's looking at the mother. She's initiating an engagement with the mother. So these observations, when you start looking, you will learn to look at what is atypical in a broader perspective. So looking at the science of self-concept and body schema, we look at sensory integration, we look at proprioceptive feedback and volition. This is what we saw in the video. And finally, you look at voluntary and planned actions. Now 3 to 7 years, an organization of senses, there is consolidation of sensory motor functions, complicated sensory motor demands, interfacing with peers, and there's a strong inner drive to produce an adaptive response. Let's look at a video if it is possible. Ragini, which one do you want me to show? This one? Three, nahi. This one?
No, ma'am, that is abnormal one.
Okay, so we don't have anything.
This the dancing girl we can show probably.
This one?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So that's, yeah, have you seen that video?
Yeah, I've seen this one.
Okay. So it's like, sorry.
So there's a very common feature which you'll see in kids of this age, that they love to dance to the tune, or possibly they love to imitate what is shown to them. And that is learning by imitation. Now our kids who are not at a compromise, this is a very common thing. You see them patting powder, you see them putting lipstick, you see them taking a crayon and scribbling on the wall. So these are activities which they naturally do because they are imitating, they are following what is happening. Our kids cannot, number one, register. If they register, they don't know what muscles to use. If they know what muscles to use, the synchronization and firing of those muscles may be at fault. And if that is also proper, possibly the proprioceptive information which is going through the joints could be at fault. So where and how praxis is looked at by the central nervous system. So which are the systems which are subserving praxis? Okay. We all know the tactile and prop, obviously. So somatosensory system, that is the DCML, which is associated with what? Number one, orientation. Okay, I have this book on my table and I can orient myself towards the book. What happened to the chat? Can't hear, ma'am.
We can hear, ma'am.
Thank you. So associated with orientation to the input, then you sequence the movement. So I will reach out for the book which is kept on the table without any compensations. I'll open the book and I'll coordinate my hands with the pages and I'll plan, okay, I want to read the book. So that's how it works. Proprioception or kinesthesis, it contributes to your body schema. Initiation of movement, speed, accuracy of timing, direction, and the duration of movement. So your tactile, your proprioception, vestibular obviously will provide a postural base for movement, initiation and sequencing, and you cannot function without looking. So this impacts your ideation, planning, and execution. Now what are the systems, major systems? The reticular system, which looks at the level of arousal. You have the kinetic and the synergic systems, which are your basal ganglia and cerebellum. Thalamus, which carries all the information to the cortex, the neocortex, that is the parietal lobe and the frontal lobe. Then the information comes down through your descending motor tracts and your limbic system. So the first process which we look at is what to do. I have to make an idea. Okay, I've seen my mother's purse, which she kept onto the sofa. I want to go and see what's in the purse. I have to understand. This is my goal. So what does my cortex do? So it is basically a cortical function. Okay. The major areas involved is the prefrontal cortex, which sets the goals, which are activated when we perform or we imagine. So the child is imagining. Mama is going to come from office. The purse is going to be kept under the table. I will go and first pull the purse and put my hand into it and pull out something. So that is what your cortical function is when you're coming to ideation. You have goal-directed sequences of movements, particularly in novel situations. Okay. But also when you're looking at the ideation part of it, one more important part of the brain which plays a very important role is your basal ganglia, which is involved in motor execution and the cognitive behavior aspects of execution. So these are your output areas, your dorsal prefrontal cortex, your ventral prefrontal cortex, your parietal cortex, and your areas of secondary motor. The supplementary motor areas are very important when it comes to praxis, and your basal ganglia, as you see here. So if you look at the loop which it forms from basal ganglia, the information is routed from the cortex through the basal ganglia. So glopus pallidus, this is called as a putamen loop. Putamen link or the loop, you can go back and read it. It is very much in detail. And this is involved in any activity which we do. Maybe it is playing a piano, maybe you're stamping your foot, maybe you're reading a book. So this is a putamen loop which comes into picture. And this, as we discussed in the previous slide, looks at motor execution and your cognitive behavioral aspects of execution. Okay, so these are the various parts, and you can see how the input goes through these areas, and from there it comes back to your posterior parietal association lobe. So this is how the connections are. Now the APA, the arcuate premotor area, is hypothesized to be the premotor component of a system which is concerned with perception, recognition, and association of a motivational significance to external inputs. Why does the purse is why is the purse my motivation? Because I want to see what mama keeps in it. I want to fiddle with what she gets from office. So that is my motivation. It is postulated to be particularly important in the production of interactive, externally contingent, or responsive action. If you have seen little kids who go to the kitchen and they pull the things out, they want novel situations. They want to do this because that really gives them feedback that, okay, you have done something which is goal-oriented, which has given you a result. And that is a feeling of joy. That is a feeling of happiness. And that's the adaptive response which that particular action gives to the child. Coming to the next step, which is planning. What happens in planning? As we saw in the previous slide, it is the lateral, premotor, and the supplementary areas, which is area 6. Okay. So what does the lateral premotor area do? It translates the strategy into movement tactics, how to do it. Now, when the movement occurs in response to external movements, events, this has a role in anticipation and preparation. What does the supplementary area do? Supplementary motor area depends on the proprioceptive inputs. Just a moment. I don't know why Rashmi is calling. Urvi, can you call up Rashmi from Thana? She's calling. Must be something urgent. So supplementary motor area depends on prop inputs, which are activated when the movement is self-initiated. This is associated with orientation of the eyes and the head and planning of bimanual and sequential movements. This is very significant in understanding the deficits in BIS, bilateral integrated sequencing. So when you're looking at two parts of your body working together, and if the child's proprioception or the body image is affected, obviously you will have deficits. So parietal lobe projections to the premotor area are the ones which are responsible for planning and coordinating movements to the external stimuli. Clear about ideation, clear about planning. I hope there's no confusion which areas are affected. So next time, whenever you all think praxis, think ideation. Ideation is your cortical function, aided by your basal ganglia activity, looking at motor execution and cognitive behavior aspects of execution. Think of the putamen loop. Think of the arcuate premotor area. And when you're thinking of planning, it is the lateral premotor and the supplementary area. That is area 6. Okay, so these are the various areas. And it is the area 5 and 7, which is also very important for us. Coming to the next slide for execution. So when you're looking at... Yeah?
Ma'am, I had a confusion in ideation one, because basal ganglia, it is written that it's about execution.
So ideation is thought to be a result of basal ganglia activity. Although basal ganglia is clearly associated with motor execution, they have been linked to cognitive and behavioral aspects of the action. Although the precise location of ideation is not clearly delineated, neither the premotor nor the supplementary motor areas are needed for ideation, nor are these regions associated with motivation. So it is the basal ganglia which is responsible for your motivation. And even your, I read another paper in which it is seen, and when we also talk about empathy, that there are certain areas in the basal ganglia which subserve your vocal intonation. So how you speak, what happens to your muscles of facial expression completely comes from your basal ganglia activity. I mentioned the reference for you here, Zitman et al. Okay, yeah, yes or no? Any more confusions?
Ma'am, the confusion is that only that if it is ideation, then how it is execution?
Because one part of it comes from execution. So you can't say only ideation. No? I can't only ideate that I want to go to the purse and do it. My imagination, my whole system needs to get involved into the ideation part of it. You think of a child imagining and a child with autism imagining the same thing. Are you understanding?
Yeah.
If you have seen the series on Sheldon, you'll understand what I'm exactly telling you. The small Sheldon, not the big one. So if you right. see them ideating, and if you see a typical child ideating, there's a big difference in their way of ideation and planning and thinking. Okay, you sit, and exactly Sheldon shows these points exactly. The way he thinks, the way he ideates in accordance of what a typical child, in comparison to what a typical child may do.
Right.
Okay. So there is a lot, if you go into, I mean, this is beyond the scope of this talk, Gagan, but if you look into basal ganglia subserve a lot of functions other than what they're actually meant to do of calibrating the movement. So when I, as a wellness coach, I'm looking at basal ganglia to explain what it does and how a human being has to be very potentially responsible for his or her emotions. A lot of your emotional behavior stems from basal ganglia. A lot of your vocal intonations come from basal ganglia. So when we teach the module on empathy to people, we always say it's a basal ganglia activity.
Right, ma'am.
Okay. So yes. It is not, the neuroscience has now come to a level. If you go through different books and you look at different articles which are coming now, a lot of behavioral imprints are there in the basal ganglia and the parts of the brain which we didn't think were actually having these functions. It is all coming as if like, okay, as we said, the hierarchical model, as opposed to what we are looking at, the information coming from all the parts of the central nervous system is what is now we are looking at even in neural plasticity.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Right. So I have done a lot of reading for this particular thing because I'm doing it not only for the physiotherapy, but for the other part of it. And you're welcome to take the articles possibly and read on it because it is very important as a therapist to understand why am I seeing this? Why am I doing this? What is it that can help me to do better?
Right, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, so ma'am. Coming to planning, I think we have finished this. Did we go through this? Yeah. So supplementary motor areas are associated with orientation of the eyes. And this is all when Ragini will talk. I want her to talk on the CPT immediately after this so that you all can relate to what I'm talking. The lateral premotor area, translation of the strategy into movement tactics. That is how to do it. When movement occurs in a response to external events, it has a role in anticipation and preparation. The SMA, supplementary motor areas, depends on prop inputs activated when the movement is self-initiated and associated with orientation of eyes and head and planning of bimanual and sequential movements, that is significance in understanding and deficits of bilateral integration. Now, looking at parietal lobe projections to premotor area. If you look at these projections here. So these are the projections which are responsible for planning and coordinating movements to your external stimuli. So there is intrinsic feedback, intrinsic stimuli, and there is extrinsic stimuli. Intrinsic stimuli comes from your proprioceptive input when the movement is self-initiated, and your extrinsic comes from the vision and whatever external stimuli you are getting. Clear? Then I go ahead. Coming to execution. When you're thinking of execution, it is the medial system, which is rapid, where you look at rapid, well-learned, skilled movement sequences, which are executed using primarily proprioceptive information and it is independent of the visual feedback monitoring, that is a ventromedial system. Okay, rapid, well-learned, skilled movement sequences which are executed without using the visual feedback. Looking at the area 5 of the parietal cortex, here comes a convergence of bilateral prop inputs from the muscles, the skin, and the joints. This paper particularly says that there are cells in area 5 which begin to fire before the movement is initiated and continue to fire even after deafferentiation and immobilization. So even if you are saying not moving for a, and this is a very important part, that people who do exercises continue to maintain that amount of tone in the body for some period, maybe for a month, 2 months, 3 months, even after you don't do that particular exercise, like in the lockdown period, if people have been going to the gym or doing a particular exercise and are now doing the same amount of input, some part of it is retained. But after some time, definitely it is a deconditioning which comes in. So your learning and your ability to do your exercise and your ability to tone your body completely depends on how much input you're getting from your central nervous system. And finally comes the cerebellum, which looks at movement integration and feedback. And there's a lot which goes into cerebellum. Again, beyond the scope of this talk, it can come into a workshop, but it acts as a comparator to the central nervous system, looking at movement accuracy. So this is one thing which I had put because I liked this particular thing. The vestibular cerebellum lobules, your 9-10 Purkinje cells, are looking at your world-centered information. That means how you're moving, the vestibular. This comes from your vestibular. Now, vestibular signals from your otolith organs and your semicircular canals come to the cerebellum. And this is your head-centered vestibular information. Now, your fastigial nucleus looks at your body center. That means your body schema is looked at by your fastigial nucleus. And it also looks at the cancellation of the signals of self-generated vestibular stimulation. So this gives you distinction between self and externally generated vestibular signals, which our kids don't have. Our kids do not get neck proprioception. Our kids do not get an efferent copy of the motor command. And that's the reason the gradation which the cerebellum does, and it creates a memory in the hippocampus, is completely lost. And that's why repetition of this movement will not be possible. You'll have to say, okay, can you do it one more time? Can you do it one more time? So they don't learn immediately. That's because all these connections in our kids are not very well formed or may have problems. This is again the types of learning in which cerebellum is involved. One can be unsupervised learning, that is your cortical learning, your reinforcement learning, which comes from your basal ganglia, that is completely dependent on what reward happens. And cerebellum looks at what errors come in between. If there is an input and there is an error, depending on what is happening, where the Purkinje cells are looking at, that much amount of plus or minus, that is gradation, is what the cerebellum does. So this is in short for you all to remember what are the different types of learning. Looking at the sensations, now not only the whole brain, but even we look at the sensations which are coming into picture. One is the tactile system, which looks at motor planning, proprioceptive system, which looks at the body schema, vestibular and visual. So the combination, integration of all this gives the information to the body from all the systems, and the body receives it from the somatosensory receptors. If this information is not precise, definitely you will have poor basis on which the body schema is built. So I can possibly stop here and we can go into the SIPET so that we can correlate, and then we'll go ahead with my talk. Ragini? Stop share. What is the chat? Yes. Thank you, Kanishka.
Ragini ma'am, you are on mute.
Yeah, I just unmuted. Just a second. So yeah, this we are starting with the Praxis test. As ma'am said, that this is, you know, beyond the scope, the test beyond the scope of this talk. So I'm just going to quickly brush up all the tests. I'm very sure all of you must be doing tests at the clinic. So here we are going to see the basic of it, like what all things we need to know. One is, how is the basic performance of the child, the motor performance? What are the how is the space visualization? How is the standing and walking balance? Because these are the tests which we do to understand the postural practice, not just the posture, sorry, to understand how is the posture. Is there any problem with the posture of the child? Is there any problem with the visual system of the child? How is the motor accuracy? How the child is performing activities? How is the if the child is not good in his handwriting, or if his motor performance in school is not great, then where the problem lies? So these are the specific tests that we usually, 17 tests, these are specific 17 tests that we do to check out the motor accuracy or the motor proficiency of the child. So mainly these tests are basically involve the visual system, your tactile system, proprioceptive system. In proprioceptive system, your body scheme and body image comes. And last is your motor accuracy. So in that, we take post-rotatory nystagmus, motor accuracy, sequential praxis, oral praxis, manual form perception, kinesthesia, finger identification, graphesthesia. Now, we are not going to talk about the kinesthesia, finger identification, graphesthesia, tactile localization, because these are the tests we all learn in our UG level. There are few tests which we don't know. In Sneha OT Proforma, we have specific tests. Those I have included in my talk. So in space visualization test, we usually go with the color recognition. So we don't need exact CPIT kit for this. Whatever things are available in the clinic, we can just go with that. Even the parents can tell you about the motor color recognition, form consistency, how is the shape, size differentiation. And ma'am had already talked about the normal development, the development of the praxis in her initial talk. So I don't think so here we'll have any problem, like depth perception, figure ground perception, and motor accuracy. So as I said, I have included few tests. So first is a space visualization test, where we usually get problem. What we need to do is we just shield the child's eyes. And you can see it in the picture. The specific CPIT test kit has these things, you know, where we get the specific shape, and the child has to just feel the shape and has to put it in the specific sorter. So there are different kind of sorters, and according to that, we do the marking. And as I said, there are a test of 17 tests. So kit of 17 tests. So for each testing, we get the accurate marking. Like there is a scoring for each test. The second is figure ground test. Now the usually parents come with the problem that a child cannot find his own things. Like if there is a drawer, he cannot find out his pen, pencil, or for girls, they cannot find out their clips. So, you know, without seeing, we just need to find out things. That is our figure ground perception. So this is affected. So what we do is we perform these tests and we get to know what is the problem. Motor accuracy, you know, for handwriting, we get the books like dotted lines. And if the child is not able to trace the line properly, in that case, we can talk about the motor accuracy. So why I'm saying these things, because if you don't have a specific kit, then also on clinic level, we can just find out what is the problem, where, you know, where we can score less to our kid. Then a form consistency. Now we can create this kit at our clinic itself. Again, in this, we usually use the color recognition, the shape recognition, the sorting, and also we put the thing in child's hand, and the child has to decide what it is exactly. Now, these are different tests which are actually taken from the OT Proforma. This is the figure, draw a figure of clock, then draw a figure or draw a face. Then we ask the child to draw himself. You know, very simple test where if the child is having a great sensitivity towards, here it's a part of a sensory integration test as well. So if the child is having hypersensitive hands, usually they draw, you know, just, this is just an example, they usually tend to draw the hands big than the other body parts. So we get an idea that, okay, this is a sensitive part. Or sometimes they just draw their face and there are no ears, or there is no nose, or there are no eyes. So we get to know that the child is having poor perception or poor understanding about his own body parts. You must have seen a lot of kids just draw their face. So you know, a lot of kids feel the things with their mouth. In such case, we get to know that the problem lies with the body scheme. So body image, body scheme go with your proprioceptive system. Post-rotatory nystagmus, there are a lot of videos available on YouTube. Please go through it. We usually perform this test to find out the visual problem. Also, the problem with the motor accuracy, bilateral motor sequencing. A lot of kids have problem with the vestibular system. We immediately get to know about post-rotatory nystagmus. This is a very beautiful test in which usually we spin the child, making them sit on the board. We get a specific scooter board, jaise board hota. So on that board, the child is going to sit. We are going to give him 10 spin. Then abruptly, we are going to stop the scooter board. And we usually perform the test 4 times. Postural praxis, very nice test. You immediately get to know about the kids who are having a problem in terms of low tone, who are having dyspraxia, SPD cases, and a nice test to perform on DCD kids. Almost 100. There are papers which says almost the accuracy is almost 9 in 9 pointers. So we get very nice postural praxis where they have low tone and they sit in a slouch. And if you ask them to do the extension, you know, anti-gravity extension, it is very difficult for them, which we can do it very easily. Sequential praxis. Now, sequential praxis in which we can perform multiple movements in a specific sequence. We can also give them pictures also, but this is very easy test you can perform at your clinic. You know, just the child is standing in front of you and you are asking, you are showing him different movements too. You are telling him to different hand movements, leg movements, or you are just telling him to tap on the table. I have given the examples, and then the child is performing that in a specific sequence. And this is, we can also use as a treatment tool. So if the child is coming to you, you can start with 2 sequences, or there are kids who start with only 1 sequence. So if you ask him, fetch me a red color ball. So these are two things. So one is fetch a ball. Second is a red color ball. So you can decide how what will be your treatment goal. Like at the end of your treatment session, what you want the child to achieve. One sequence or a 2 sequence. Okay, command processing. Then we have oral praxis. Now, oral praxis, very simple test. Again, at clinic level, we can perform it. You are just going to do different, gestures with your face, and the child is going to perform the same thing. There are a lot of kids with the speech delay who has problem in performing oral praxis, because this is also related with your oromotor structure and your oral muscles. So for this, child has to plan. Like this is, I know this is very difficult to understand, but if you want to do a blowing activity, you have to take your all muscles in a this position, your pout position. So for this also, we need a planning. And then the execution happens, which is not possible in our kid with DCDs or dyspraxia. Now, manual form perception. I think I have not added the picture for this. So what we do is usually we perform this test. I think we'll skip this test because these are like, this is not a simple test. I'm going to add test which we can do it at clinic level. Okay. And if we are having another talk on the praxis test, definitely we'll cover it. Or usually ma'am cover it in a SI advanced course, because this is a part of advanced course. So bilateral motor coordination. In bilateral motor coordination, we usually do it with the whole body. Okay. So it's not only finger movements, but this is the bilateral coordination of your two sides of your body. So in that we usually perform a lot of tests. Yes, I have added it here. So this is the first part which you can see. It is also come under bilateral motor coordination, where we do jumping jacks and a lot of movement at different joints of your body. So if I'm doing a clapping activity, which is very much easier for me, the same activity will be difficult for the child who is having probably dyspraxia. So the child will have difficulty in bringing this hand and this hand together. And instead of doing this, they may be turn up doing this. Okay. Or if the test is easier, what we can do is we can increase the difficulty level by giving the hand and the leg, or hand and the ear, or hand and the head, the different body parts, not the symmetry, asymmetry. The constructional praxis. Now, constructional praxis, last two pictures, you can see this using of scissor, as ma'am said. Usually, these tests we administered at the age of 4 years, till 7 years, 11 months, that is still 8 years. Or I'm sorry, 8 years, 11 months. So in these ideal age span, we need to know how we do the cutting thing, how we do the sticking thing, or putting things inside out, or, you know, probably putting shapes on each other, like the shape sorting.
So each, can I interrupt?
Yes, ma'am.
Each of the test has its own function, which you look at, subservient function. And each of this test has particular conditions. The administration of these tests is beyond the scope of the talk. It can be done in an advanced sensory integration workshop. It is just for you all to understand that these are the tests. If you look at any article, if you all don't have the article, I can forward that to you. These tests are mentioned in a standard way. Here, the basic aim for you all to understand is how praxis is related and what are the different ways in which we can look at praxis in form of testing. That was the objective of putting these tests here.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, again, the praxis on verbal commands. There are, a specific test. We usually perform this test in a sequence, specific sequence, where we do different gestures or postures of the body. And it is observed in sitting as well as in standing. So the therapist does few things and the child has, therapist tell few things and the child has to perform the things in a similar way. So at clinic level, we say a lot of things like Simon Says games. We have in Hindi, oranges and lemon, not Hindi, it's English only, but Indian version. So oranges and lemon. So in these things, we can incorporate the activity and in a group session also, you know, for multiple kids, we can do this test at multiple level. And this is not just a diagnostic tool. Please use it as a treatment tool as well. I'm not sure ma'am is going to share videos of the group session, but in that, I think we have done this kind of test. Ma'am? I think this was my last slide. So total 17 tests. And I have just, as I said, I'm just going through it quickly because this is not part of this talk. Ma'am?
Yeah, I'm there. I'm just okay. Trying to, you have to stop screen sharing and then I can start the screen sharing.
I'm so sorry. Just a second. Yes.
Okay. So you all can, 1 minute. Can I share screen? There you go. Share. Where is my ear? Hello. Download. Praxis final. And Praxis videos. So let's start with video number one. I think we have 5 minutes or more. Let us see. Tell me what is the problem you find in this child. Quickly, see what's happening. Orientation, registration. Could you all note that down? Could you all see this, what she did? You can see the video, right? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So registration, orientation. Didn't know what she could do.
Ma'am, distraction also. because she got up and she went to the other side.
Yeah, so coming to that. So when Gagan asked me this question of basal ganglia involvement, you can see in this child how her executive functions are affected, her cognitive functions, as well as her ability to attend. And this was a child who was a preterm child. She was from our NICU and she had taken therapy with us. And then after she started walking, the parents felt now therapy is no longer essential. And she came to me when she started going to the Montessori level. She was from Mauritius. And she came even after that. She came at age 6, age 7. And then she stopped. But that time the parents really understood what was the meaning of early intervention. Coming to this, I think the second one which I want to show you all is, I think this is Ragini's favorite video and she'll be very happy to see this video. And if you remember, Ragini, the conversation we had at this time when we were handling him.
I don't remember this video. It's been so many years.
So this is the time when Ragini asked me about his praxis and she said, why do you think that he is not able to do these steps very well? Is it the difficulty because of his formation planning was the question, vision or vestibular? What system is coming into play? Right? And then we had discussed about this activity where we kept, this was not there. Then we brought this into picture and we said, let him have a goal of keeping the tree here so that he can fix his vision, climb up the steps and fetch something. So when you're looking at the systems which a child is not using, suppose this was not around. This was not there initially. Okay? The child will not climb up the steps because there is no goal which he can make or ideate. I want to go and reach out for this toy or this fruit and come down. The moment you keep a goal for it, which he can ideate, which he can register, his body starts working very well. Okay? So always keeping a goal for the child to ideate, for the child to understand what he will do. What is his function going to be is very important, even if the child has issues. And he did really well. He climbed up the steps. Before that, he was not doing it on his own. Remember, madam?
Yes, yes, I do remember.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So this was another one I wanted to show you all. The third one is, yeah, I didn't get the group session, but I got this fellow. Who was our favorite?
Your favorite.
Yeah, my favorite.
God.
You can see his tone conveys a lot. His body image conveys a lot.
Can't see the video.
Pardon? You can't see the video?
No. Ma'am, it's playing. It's half screen.
Yeah, it is. It's that. I mean, from the on the laptop, you can see it completely.
And we can see it.
Yeah.
So
you can see he's not able to do the commands at all. See what he's doing. See the jumping jack. There he goes. And we have one more video of him.
So bilateral motor coordination and sequencing.
Or it's house car. I think this was the one. Yeah, see this. You can see this one. He just doesn't know. Look at that. Crossing midline. And that is where your corpus callosum comes into picture. Last time I had asked you all a question. The answer was corpus callosum. Or this. Okay. Now coming to my presentation, why did it disappear? Yeah, it stopped here. Visible to everyone?
Yeah.
Visible? Yeah. So we are looking at other theories also for praxis. Why am I echoing? Am I echoing or is it fine?
Somebody is now not okay. Muted there themselves.
Yeah. Okay, so motor control theories, we all know that Shambhikup has come up with a wonderful, I'm still echoing. Is it known, right? Am I clear?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So movement, they say, emerges from TIE, that is task, the individual, and the environment. And motor control focuses on these aspects to explain the development of movement. What are the factors within the individual? It is the control and coordination of movement, muscles, and degrees of freedom. What happened in the chat? Kindly mute everyone. Okay. Sensation and perception, that is information about the state of the body and the environment, and the cognition of the child, which you saw in all these kids whom we showed you, whether it was Anaya and that boy, the action, the sensation, perception, and cognition, that is intention, motivations, and emotions were affected. Looking at the closed loop and the open loop theory by Adams in 1971 and schema theory, that is by Schmidt in 1978, according to the schema theory, learning consists of constant updating of motor and sensory schemas with each movement that is made. Practice gradually builds up the motor program and develops an appropriate representation of action. Suppose you take any action which a child performs for the first time, you know, he's going to ride a bicycle. The first time he looks at it, he looks at the bicycle, he says, oh, really, I have to sit on the bicycle and ride it. And he's just trying to form a program within himself. So once he starts practicing, he builds up that program. Okay, I'm going to climb up the cycle from my left side. My left leg goes up and then I'm going to hold this handle with my left hand, right hand. I'm going to balance myself and ride the cycle. The moment there is a change in the way he is going to approach that cycle, comes from the right to the left, there's an entire change in the body scheme and the body program. So this is very applicable when you think of our children. In typical children, this happens naturally. But when you're looking at children who have praxis issues, these are little components which you need to think of. And that's why these theories are very important for us to know. Looking at planning and programming, which is the most important and essential process in praxis, we have done this. I don't think we want to go into details of it. It's just one of the papers which I had got, which says that temporal ordering of sequence of operations is necessary to perform a required act efficiently. Okay, so that is exactly what I spoke in this particular theory, is what we have to understand, that when you're looking at strategizing for a child, a simple act of opening the purse, opening the drawer, the temporal ordering, how do I go? Do I squat? Do I stand? Where should my right hand be? Where should my left hand be? All these things are very important. When you're looking at programming, there should be construction of motor programs on the basis of acquired rules and actual information which is available from the environment. And when you're looking at sequencing or ordering a series of movements, this is central in your motor planning and programming. Most of our kids, which you saw just now, the sequencing or the way the things are carried out is not at all there. And that's why sequencing praxis becomes an important element for us to work on. Now you're looking at what are the other difficulties in the area of development? When I went through this particular paper and dissertation, and it was a very interesting dissertation on the clumsy child. Most often we always attribute a clumsy child to DCD, praxis, etc. And this dissertation has carried very important facts that a child with having an orthopedic problem like arthrogryposis, maybe he's having some problem with his respiratory system, can also be clumsy. And why will he be clumsy? So this is coming from the dynamic systems theory, which they attributed. Again, these are articles which are open for reading. I'll share them with you. So when you're looking at all these things, a self-concept, that is, I feel less competent and I feel less accepted by my peer group. Even if my endurance is affected, I'm not able to compete with them. I'm not able to go and play a football match with them. The social behaviors become affected. That is, you become more introvert, more insecure. You have that feeling of not being happy. I don't want to go to school because what others think of me is not what I like. I have a trouble deciding now what to do. So I'm constantly in a state of to do or not to do. looking at adolescent, the areas of occupational performance that may be affected by praxis, your self-concept, of course, your physical ability, your ability to write, your ability to form relationships, your ability to plan for the organization. Sometimes you feel some of these individuals have so much latency, you have to push them, prod them. Why are you not working? What is happening? And okay, that the, and later on, if you go into the history, possibly these are the kids who could have had a DCD in their childhood. So looking at praxis disorders, categorically, you look at something which is somatodyspraxia coming from the skin and the proprioception, visual dyspraxia, dyspraxia on verbal commands, and bilateral integration and sequencing difficulties. Now looking at somatodyspraxia, this is a child who's clumsy, who falls frequently, bumps into things, who has poor gross motor balance and prefers sedentary tasks, poor fine motor skills, including construction and manipulatory play. They have motor and or spatial deficits. They have delayed ADLs like fastenings, milk cartons, makeup. So anything comes into their hand, if they want to hold and they want to do, everything spills down. So if they want to open their water bottle, they can't do that because it's a fine motor thing, and then sipping from that water bottle becomes a problem. The major motor development, major developmental milestones, okay, sort of, thoda sa late tha. Like yesterday I saw a child who was almost into this category, 14 months, 15 months, just able to walk. So the parents feel, okay, everything is fine, low tone, locking his joints. There could be accompanying learning disabilities with frequently poor spelling, reading and maths. This dysdiadokinesia, that is in-hand manipulation and thumb finger touching, poor postural praxis, tactile discrimination may be impaired. In a more severe disorder, it can combine disorders of planning, execution of projected action sequences, and deficits in planning and execution, which are responsive motor actions. This could be associated with tactile processing deficits, and their vestibular proprioceptive processing may be impaired. Sorry. So this is a summary of your somatopraxis and somatosensory. So when you're looking at only somatosensory, you're looking at graphesthesia. These are the tests which are affected. Graphesthesia, finger identification. And this you will not be able to understand unless you do the SIPET in detail. We are just outlining these things to you, that these tests could be affected when you're looking at a somatodyspraxia. When you're looking at a deficit which is only somatosensory, then these are the ones which are affected. Okay, so when you're looking at prop plus tactile, you have postural praxis, oral praxis. When you have only tactile, it is graphesthesia, finger identification, localization of tactile stimuli, and manual form perception. So somatodyspraxia versus somatosensory. Now looking at visual praxis, deficits may be end products of sensory integration dysfunction due to right hemisphere cortical dysfunction. This includes three types: poor form and space perception, poor visuomotor coordination, and poor constructional abilities. Sorry. So these are the various tests. Again, how do you come to a conclusion the child has these issues? One, by your clinical observation, by your history taking, and second, by doing your SIPET. So these are the various types of visual dyspraxias which are seen, and these are the tests which could be affected. So when you're looking at visual construction, you're looking at constructional praxis being affected. When I look at motor accuracy test and your design copying. When you're looking at visual perception, your SV, your DC and FG is affected. And when you're looking at visual motor, you're looking at MAT and your design copying. So these are the various parts of your SIPET test which could get affected. Coming to praxis on verbal commands, okay? So they always have low scores on praxis of with VC, heightened post-rotatory nystagmus, and their sequencing tests also may be low. When you're looking at BISD, it's a praxis disorder with vestibular and prop deficits. It's a disorder of planning and execution of projected action sequences, but there are difficulties with activities that need alternating movements. Often has been able to function efficiently for a long time, but they perform it very slowly. Timed activities are difficult. You saw that big boy showing you all these difficulties. Difficulty in performing anticipatory motor action. There's a postural ocular movement disorder. They score low on bimanual motor coordination and low on sequencing praxis. This also may contribute to oral praxis, postural praxis, and graphesthesia. So when are these deficits seen? they are seen in DCDs, autism, and in other cases. We discussed this last time. I won't go into details of this. I just wanted to come to this small thing. I think this we have covered last time. Okay, this is something what she went through, but in on one slide, these are the various tests. Your test, tactile, vestibular, and prop tests are these many. Your spatial visualization tests, your visual praxis tests, visuospatial tests, praxis, VSID, and single test. So this is in a nutshell what your SIPT gives you when you're doing your testing. There are 17 tests which are there on CIPET. Needless to say, there's a way, particular way in which you carry out these tests in India, and people who don't have the kit can do it, but these are not certified. So if you want to do a certified test, you need to have the kit, you need to have the complete forms and the computer analysis, etc., etc. So it is a multifactorial skill. Observation is very essential. You have to look at all the entire picture which the child is giving you at school, with his friends, in the playground, at home, at school, at playground, and also how the relationships are formed. Then you do the CIPET, and then you look at meaningful clusters which come to you. Need for intervention, very, very important. You have to give motor intervention, intervention in these kids, because the moment you say we are not going to intervene, they are not going to perform. Even if kids who are preterms, and this is where I'm a strong believer that kids who start walking after taking therapy in the first month of life, it is not that you can discharge them, because the moment you don't give physical input, their learning suffers. Their self-esteem goes down and their ideation, planning in later life suffers. So this is exactly what is seen here. So you definitely give them a lot of other interventions nowadays. Gaming is there, hypotherapy is there, metronome training is there, aquatic therapy. I don't know. I've not gone into all the details of these. I just mentioned. But what we do at SNEA is definitely task-oriented approach. We give sensory integration. We do a lot of proprioceptive activities using TheraBand. We use balls. We use goal-oriented therapy. And that's how we reach our goals. So this is something which I wanted to share with you all. The three slides which I had hidden. When Ragini was taking our talk, I just unhid them. This is a good paper which I read from, that performance of movements to verbal commands would be most difficult. Performance of movements to imitation, less difficult. Okay, so when you're saying something and the child is going to perform, it is most difficult. That's what these people have found out in 1973, 75 and 85. And they have done a good amount of work when it comes to praxis. Subsequent researchers supported this view and found out that adults with apraxia were able to perform more accurately to imitation and than to verbal commands. Okay, so if you want to get the work done out of the child, more than telling, it is doing the work with the child which helps the child a lot. So that is one. Second, Jeshwin suggested that praxis network may have a bi-hemispheric representation. More often than language, and performance may improve in imitation conditions because it is initiated and carried out by the right hemisphere. So coming to the last part, which is autism and praxis. So why in autism praxis could be affected? Because there's an impairment in overall imitation abilities. That is body movement. Please mute yourself. Oral facial imitation and imitations of actions on objects. Praxis as a strong predictor of defining features of autism after accounting for basic motor skills. It is strongly related with social, communicative and behavioral impairments. Dyspraxia may be a core feature in autism or a marker of neurological abnormalities underlying the disorder. So children with ASD exhibited relatively good visual praxis, scores deficient in somatopraxis, vestibular balance and bilateral motor test scores. I think that was end. We stop share.
Well, just to add that we also see effective praxis in a lot of LDs, whatever LD comes to us. So, you know, it is very efficient test. I'm enforcing on this point that it is not just a functional test or the diagnostic tool. Please use it as a treatment tool as well. As ma'am showed rightly in the Fraser's video, the small boy with me, that we kept a goal that, you know, he should do certain activities. Though, you know, as a therapist, though we say the ideation is important, the planning is important, but all of us usually focus on the execution, right? That, because that's the final point where the parents are going to see the improvement is there or not. So I think we should use it as a diagnostic tool as well as the treatment tool. And in that, we can incorporate these all points, like the visual praxis, the constructional praxis, the sequencing, motor planning, everything. That was just add on from my side.
Thank you.
Ma'am, I think there is only one question for this talk right now.
Oh, yeah.
So it says, in sequencing practice, does the therapist give commands verbally or the therapist performs?
So as you said, saw just now, it is imitation, yeah, which we do. It's imitation. So in many of the tests, we use the voice. In many of the tests, we use imitation. Each test has its conditions and each test has its particular ways. So recently I underwent this testing for SIPET and they had a, I had a peer group review from one of the therapists who had done. So in India, there are very few qualified SIPET therapists, and I'm proud to say that I finished my certification in SIPET now. I'm awaiting the certificate in person. But the conditions and the way you do SIPET is very, very different than what you would ordinarily do. It requires a lot of expertise. Okay, anything else? I think we can do a brief one next time. Mehika, I don't know what she'll say on therapy. We can have a brief discussion before we start, the maybe about a 10-minute discussion of principles, yeah, of therapy, and then we can go ahead with what is the topic y'all are deciding, whatever y'all decide. Yeah.
Okay.
Done?
Yeah, ma'am. If there are any questions, please get with us.
And also suggestions for topics. One more thing is, Mika, if they want any topics which they find are relevant to them or they want to be covered, they can give you all suggestions and we can take it accordingly.
Okay.
And I would also share all my articles. I'll share my articles with Mika just now so that we don't miss out.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Welcome. Yeah. LH team, please remain back. We need to discuss. Yeah.
So, guys, we are going to have a webinar for parents on nutrition. It will be on 16th May. So you can share this picture or contact Latifa. You can share the contact for Latifa with your parents and they can get back to for this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Ragini, ma'am.
Welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye.
Stay safe.
You too, ma'am. Take care.
Maybe they had accepted
it, that you might get. That is what happens until.
Ma'am, I just posted one topic. Please take that one. Neurochemical imbalance in autism.
Oh, please email us the topic.
Okay, yeah, fine. I'll do that. Thank you.
Arya, you can stop sharing the picture.
Yeah, I was going to say that.
Thank you.
Are the participants please leave? We have a team meeting right now.
There are three Snehal Deshpandes. Wow. Even I logged in from ma'am's ID. I didn't realize it was your ID on my phone. Sorry.
That's why you are my... This was making noise. Naughty girl.
No, I was not there right now. I mean, hey. I was not in the Learning Wednesday meeting.
You can come here. We can sit together. It will be different.
No, I'm not in a good state to be seen. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it is us only.
Shreya, yeah. Shreya sir, ke koi hai?
Meera ma'am and
Shreya.
Shreya. Hi, Meera. Meera, we have to see Chari together.
Geeli gati ne aaye.
Meera, Chari la phone karayla lagna.
I think she just pressed back and she's not ended the meeting. Let me just
look.
I think ho gaya sir.
Ho gaya.
Yes.
Hi.
Hello, ma'am. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Hi, ma'am.
How are you all?
Yeah.
How are you all?
Hi, ma'am.
It's funny for me to see three Snehal ma'ams here in front of me.
I'm scared. I'm feeling like Matrix.
Ah, exactly. The same picture is going on every thing. My God.
Bolo, agenda of the meeting, Sukanya madam, you wanted everyone of us to talk.
Yes, ma'am. Since we spoke yesterday, I thought we can talk together. So, what we spoke yesterday, with that, I can start coming there. I had said yesterday. So
just to update, yesterday I had been and I was taken care of like a VVVIP. Needless to say, everyone is running back and forth. Hey Paijeka, Te Paijeka, right from Shashikant Pawar to the IT department. So everyone came running. The computer was taken care of. Except for our performers. I don't know where the performers are. Who is not on
Rinkesh is not here.
नहीं वारा वारा कुटुंद्रे रिंकेश नहीं है का मीटिंग मध्ये अच्छा ठीक आहे यू विल टेल हिम सो आई डिडंट हैव नंबर 1 व्हाट आई मिस्ड इज द चिट ब्लॉक्स देयर वाज वन चिंटूसा पेन वी नीड टू कीप पेन्स आउट देयर और चिट ब्लॉक्स नहीं है परफॉर्मर्स आई जस्ट डिड ऑन द लेटर हेड द हिस्ट्री आई सॉ द चाइल्ड देयर वाज अ 14 मंथ ओल्ड बेबी हु हैड कम आई ट्राइड टेलिंग द पेरेंट्स बट दे वर लाइक ओके वी आर फाइन कमिंग सो द मदर वाज अ टेक person. She had stopped working, but very typical history of I was busy with my exams and I didn't communicate. And lockdown period chalo. I said lockdown to abhi chalo ho gaya. But the it was a very clear case of not giving attention. This child had self-stimulation and he went and licked the entire mirror. I was scared because though the department was clean, he was licking all over the place and I was like, what karun kya? But then somehow, and the parents were least concerned. there's a form which they have given me, which each parent has to sign. Number one, where they have all those conditions that there are no fever, no this, no that. And secondly, that they won't hold the doctor responsible or the hospital responsible if they develop any signs and symptoms of fever. So this is a declaration what they have to give. You all saw the video which I put, and exactly as it is on the video, the thing is all doctors are wearing pink scrubs. So they will give us pink scrubs to wear so we can go there, we can change into that uniform. We can be with the whole thing and the cap, the whole gear and the two masks and our gloves. So this is what they are giving us. Good sanitation, good footwear. So everything is provided by them. There is no need to go fuzzy about that. But also people who want to take prophylaxis, everyone in the hospital. I met Anita Soni. I went to her room. I went and met our Ahuja. Ahuja is referring one patient every single day. You know who is baby of Neha? Who is baby of Neha from high risk?
Yes, ma'am. There is this Neha. I can't Neha tell you who.
Yes. Or something. So it seems the babies are delayed and okay. She did not bother to follow up. So he has referred her yesterday. So Sanjeev is referring babies regularly. I went and met Bijal, was not around. I met Soni. I met Pahuja, Shalini, Suralkar. All these people I met. So they come, they finish off their work and they go. That's what they're doing. So it is just the feeling that the department is open and it is giving a positive vibe. That's all what we have to do. Presently, patients, whichever are coming, we have to start taking them very slowly. Tomorrow also I'm coming. Whoever is coming, Mitali or Kanishka, you all decide. But I'm coming. I'm excited to come because I'm liking going there, needless to say. And Gaude patient, Swara Gaude, Kanishka, you can ask her when they want to come. And you can ask Srinivas Gowda. These are two babies who can come. That Kashmiri baby, I've told him Saturday you can come. Don't come on Thursday. He will require therapy thrice to four times a week. ASD have a proper with low tone, but eventually he'll require a neuro opinion as well. So we can refer him to Anaita, whoever is seeing him next. Okay, so this is what I wanted to update. And water, I carried my own water. I didn't take my bag up there. I just took a small wallet, a pen and my specs. And when I came out, I nicely scrubbed, washed my hands, removed everything and I came back. So that is the way we
have. So ma'am, suppose we go to the hospital, where are we supposed to get our scrubs and everything from?
Sisters come running behind you the moment you go there. The Maushi cleans the room and keeps it. You have to go to the that small area where Vaishali sits. In fact, I took the printout also. Yesterday, printer, they sorted that they gave me printouts. And okay. I gave the child the printout from 0 to 3 for 14 months. And they took it back home with them. So that's all what I did. So they are ready to help the sisters there. The gown was coming out like that day. So they put the, you were not there to put the micropores. I ran to the nursing station. I put the micropore. So that gown was flimsy. So everyone was telling me, why are you wearing it? And I saw them all wearing pink uniforms. So they are ready to give us the pink scrubs and everything to do whatever is required. And that's the reason I'm coming persistently, because unless I come, this habit of, you know, the giving things or following orders may not happen. So that's the reason I'm coming tomorrow also and on Saturday also. I don't mind coming because I feel it's very safe out there and they are taking good care of the infection, etc. That's what I felt.
Ma'am, in fact, there were a few patients who were preferring coming to the hospital. They said from next week we'll start the new patients because they don't want a home visit, as the precautions are not that much in a home visit. So they said he would want the doctor to be in the suit and mask and gloves and everything, and the temperature to be checked. So I said that can't happen in a home visit. So they said then we'll contact you to take appointments in the hospital for next week, or if you open your clinics, we will come there.
Okay. Dr. Sukanya, how are you planning to come?
By bus. I'm planning to come.
Janvi Rankave is coming every day. She has not missed a single
day. By bus, ma'am?
I think so.
Okay.
Even Ratan.
The BST bus, Ratan, or we have the hospital.
BST bus.
There are special
buses. I found out. Little bit, I think 10 minutes
from there I'll have to just walk. Same. But that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if ma'am, if we can do now, it's like Dr. Sukanya is also there. If we can do like two therapists and you know, like we'll have company, because even I'm going to be traveling either by auto.
I'm coming. Yeah. So this week I'm coming. So this week is Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. Next week you all decide how you all want to go. So maybe the other days we can have the other two therapists going. And Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, I will persistently come. I will be there. So whoever 3 days can away? Come. Yeah, I don't mind at all. You have to start working now.
Let's Mom, go. We're going tomorrow. Like
So between Mithali
anything, and
Krishna, I think...
Ma'am, what I can suggest is to start with, let us plan thrice a week. If you're going, one person with you comes. So they come once a week.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think they should accompany with you to start with, and later on we can start individual. So let us start with Tuesday. Tuesday, Thursday and Friday for now for everyone.
Saturday. Why sorry, Saturday is the Saturday? There are many patients who can come on Saturday. The fathers have chutti on Saturday.
Okay, so let us keep it for 3 days for everybody right now. And you being common and one person taking turns to come with you as per the patients. So like that you can start with, and after 17th, we'll see how things are going with the government and everything. And then we'll decide the other things.
No problem.
Okay.
Yeah. So tomorrow you all.
So decide. Not a lot of crowd, just one person with ma'am should be good. Like max one person.
So you all decide and team up and let me know. And okay, patients you all start giving. If your that Pawai patient wants to come, you can take him when you're coming. Whoever wants to come can come.
Okay.
So maybe what you all can do is when you all talk to your patients, you all can tell them that there are a lot of precautions taken. If they want to see the video, you all can send it. I sent the video which ma'am sent now. I sent it to this new patient. So they were more convinced for coming to the hospital from next week rather than taking a home visit. So maybe that might just encourage them, seeing that there are a lot of precautions taken inside the hospital. Because right now, what common people are thinking is there are no precautions taken anywhere and it's very...
So, when we go tomorrow, we'll have to make a folder for the signed papers. We have to keep chit blocks. So, all these things we can do tomorrow, whoever is coming. Keeping pre-consults, because everything I had to write down. I didn't find anything. Even sensory profile, I had to run inside, search. I don't know, since I'm so dependent on all of you all. I'll have to see where it takes place. Toys I didn't remove. I just saw the baby. Slowly we can. And then we can have them sanitized. Not a problem. Thrice a day they are going to sanitize. And after the patient goes also they will sanitize. And the Anita Savant told me, if they don't do, just come and tell me. If anyone, anything is not available to you, just come. We will give you. Don't worry. So the hospital is quite supportive. And I feel that's a good way, positive way of starting the whole thing slowly and not jumping. So they are encouraging everyone, even if it's one patient, they say don't bother. Even if patients are not, they just come, sit for some time and go. So that the positive atmosphere starts building. And everyone, I'm telling you, come with a positive attitude ki there's nothing what is going to go wrong. And everything is taken care of. If their attitude is positive, I don't think anything will be going wrong anywhere. This is what I would like to say. I feel that. The initial weeks I used to feel when I went. But now I don't feel. Yesterday I was jumping all around the place. But don't go. Don't venture out above the first floor. That is also there. Just remain on the first floor. Be there and then come down. That is not a problem at all. And social distancing. Maintaining the distance of 6 feet from a person. Not being in a contact with the person for more than a second or 2 seconds. Not talking to them. As I kept the patient's care sitting far away. The baby I handled, I saw his stone, I saw his popliteal angle, his ankle. But that was with that headgear and all. So it was good enough for me, not a problem.
Okay.
And please, if you all are not able to, if there are patients who are not coming, please encourage them to take online sessions, because it's high time. 1 and 2 months, I'm sure the patients may have got berserk in their own ways. So please encourage them to take online sessions, if not personal sessions. Okay.
I think y'all should be a little firm now rather than telling them to take. Y'all need to tell them that it is high time. You cannot take such a long break. So you decide what you want to do. Okay.
Questions? I like that cat in Umaira's picture. Good to see all of you. Missing all of you.
Same here, ma'am.
Shilpa, there she comes from her mobile. Chalo, take care.
Yeah. Bye, ma'am.
Okay?
Meet Bye.
Good job. Good job for today.
So, Kanya will connect later for the other things. Arishi left also. Okay.
Good. Thank you, Arya, Mihika.
Purvi, welcome.
Phone hai.
Main hoon, main Mitali.
Hello. Haan? Haan, Mitali, bolo na.
Yeah. Today ka patient ka Zoom link will you send me or do I send
Yeah, I'll make from ma'am ka thing. And then she will be able to, matlab it will be extended for a longer time then, that's why.
Okay, so 7 o'clock. Okay, you just send
seven, na? Okay, okay. I'll send you the link. Yeah, done. Bye.
Okay, thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye.